Welcome to the service from St. James Church, Mangotsfield, for this, the 3rd of January, 2021. Happy New Year. Our service today will be a New Year service, but will also be our celebration of Epiphany. I'm going to begin with a couple of sentences from the scriptures from the book of Proverbs and the letter to the Philippians. Many are the plans in the human heart, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will be established. Do not be anxious. In everything, make your requests known to God in prayer and petition with thanksgiving. And a prayer for the New Year. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose years never fail, and whose mercies are new each returning day, let the radiance of your Spirit renew our lives, warming our hearts and giving light to our minds, that we may pass the coming year in joyful obedience and firm faith, through him who is the beginning and the end, your Son, Christ our Lord. Amen. And let's remind ourselves of the reasons we gather together in whatever way we can, whether as here in our homes or sometimes in our churches. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. We come now to our time of confession as we acknowledge in the quiet of our own hearts and in the presence of God, our own shortcomings, failings, and failures in the past few days. But we ask his forgiveness, we accept his forgiveness, and we look to the future with comfort and with new strength. The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. Let us then confess our sins. Lord Jesus, illuminate the darkness in our hearts. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, open our eyes to your saving love. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, unstop our ears to hear your living word. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And having made our confession, we now receive and accept God's forgiveness. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue with a few moments just to reflect on, not on the things we've done wrong, that's behind us now, but to reflect on the things that matter to us and the future, of course, that lies before us. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. And just a few moments of quiet now as we offer our personal thoughts and thanks and concerns to God. And so as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, and indeed this new year, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen.
Yeah.
And our canticle, which we're going to have now, is called the Song of New Jerusalem. And it's especially for the Epiphany season. I'm going to read the first line of each verse, and I invite you to join with me in the second line of each verse. Arise, shine out, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord is rising upon you. Though night still covers the earth, and darkness the peoples, above you the Holy One arises, and above you God's glory appears. The nations will come to your light, and kings to your dawning brightness. Your gates will lie open continually, shut neither by day nor by night. The sound of violence shall be heard no longer in your land, or ruin and devastation within your borders. You will call your walls salvation, and your gates praise. No more will the sun give you daylight, nor moonlight shine upon you, but the Lord will be your everlasting light. Your God will be your splendor. For you shall be called the city of God, the dwelling of the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen.
The reading today is taken from Isaiah chapter 60, reading verses 1 to 7. The glory of Zion. Arise, shine, for the light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the people. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look about you. All assemble and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters are carried on the hip. Then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. The wealth of the seas will be brought to you. To you the riches of the nations will come. Herds of camel will cover your land. Young camels of Midian and Ephah, and all from Sheba will come, bearing gold and incense, and proclaiming the praise of the Lord. All Kedar's flocks will be gathered to you. The rams of Nebaioth will serve you. They will be accepted as offerings on my altar, and I will adorn my glorious temple. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Jesus, the light of the world. To everyone. I think that greeting this year is particularly heartfelt, and I really do hope that much of your year will contain moments of joy and maybe relief from the year we've just had. Not all relationships are 100% compatible. Peter and I have a porridge incompatibility. I like mine quite smooth and runny, and maybe with a little bit of milk. He likes his gloopy, fairly rubbery, made completely with water and with some salt sprinkled on afterwards. It may be his Scots genes that are coming out. And if that's not enough, we also have an incompatibility in our biological clocks. He's very often the most creative and industrious last thing at night and maybe into the early hours, whereas I maybe after about 10 o'clock become quite cranky. And of course I grew up on a farm, so perhaps it's in my genes to get up early and get on with it. Maybe for you, an owl or a lark, do the words rise and shine incite dread and stress? The opening phrases of our reading today in Isaiah are, "Arise, shine, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord rises upon you." It begins what are three chapters of a very contained and concise message of God's salvation. God sent Isaiah to proclaim that salvation was at hand. And this was said amidst warnings and judgment on those who had forgotten or dismissed God. And it was aimed particularly at those who regarded themselves as God's people or as religious. The season of Epiphany, celebrated this week, is all about how God is for all. The wise men's arrival signified that God in Christ is for every single person. Every single person in the world of all diversity. It was a promise extended to everyone in Isaiah's time and in New Testament times beyond the Jewish nation. Isaiah speaks of the Lord rises upon you, his glory appears. It's about the rising of light despite the darkness. In Isaiah's time, there was a lot of darkness. Jerusalem was in ruins. They'd just returned from exile in Babylon, and they had a hard journey ahead of them. It's a little bit reminiscent of how we may feel. We have the inevitable slight flatness that many of us feel after Christmas and the new year period. And this year it's compounded by our society, and indeed societies across the world, being emotionally and economically drained. For the owls of this world, it's like being awakened early from a deep sleep when we feel inadequate to face the day. Isaiah's proclamation, however, is to cease to be weary, to arise, and the translation suggests a beaming look on the face. Pictured in Isaiah's words, the light on Zion, that's the city of God, leaves the rest in darkness by comparison. And God's light in our lives does make life without him seem particularly empty and gloomy. And that's the experience of many who have faith. These early verses also suggest that the light on God's people is to be extended to shine out to the rest of the world. And that is the message of Epiphany. Another translation of verses 1 and 2 in this chapter are, stand up and let us see you in your radiant glory. It's as if God is saying, give us a twirl. Allow the world to see us at our best, bathed in God's radiance. And let that light of God bounce back out into the world. This surely is our New Year challenge to every single one of us, to extend the hope and the love which God has given us, to extend it into the world, into our own world, those we love, those we work with, all those whom our lives touch, to literally bring joy to the world. Subsequent verses bring pictures of the reasons for this radiance. In the short term, Isaiah's prophecies show God's people, having come back from exile in Babylon, supporting each other. It talks of sons and daughters on the hips. They're lifting each other up when they can't walk for themselves. They're helping each other along the journey. They're accompanied by images of wealth, lines of camels carrying provisions and treasures. We can't know how much or how little a literal interpretation of this passage will be for us. I suspect most of us remain fairly sceptical about any wealth and rising economy. However, the promise of spiritual wealth remains true to any who allow God's light to shine on them. So what does our God bring to us today, and indeed always? He does bring a light in darkness, a radiance. He does bring energy as if a new day has just dawned. He brings a promise of change. He brings spiritual wealth and abundance, God's provision. And he brings us an example of sacrifice. Because finally, in verse 7, we have the rams who serve God's people, as it's expressed. It's a picture of rams destined for sacrifice, willingly approaching the altar. Now that sits slightly uncomfortably because it's a slightly grim picture of an animal facing the ultimate sacrifice, knowingly and of their own free will. But it is a poignant picture of Christ's willing sacrifice, coming into our world to face the ultimate giving of everything for each one of us. How do we access this God? How do you conceive him? C.S. Lewis, a 20th century theologian, he offers options on how we might approach God. God to many may be an impersonal God, a subjective view of beauty, truth, and goodness that is inside our heads. It may be true, but it's restricted to how we like to think of God. It's a God in our own making. God may be imagined as a formless life force surging through us, a vast power that we can tap at will. But God himself is a person. He's alive. He approaches us with speed. He's seeking us out. He's there as our king, a ruler who wants the very best for each one of us. He also comes to us as a spouse, an intimate, concrete, tangible, willing and active God who wants to form a very personal relationship with us, a God who's found us. And that's what Christmas and Epiphany are all about. And it remains to us to seek him out. We have a tabby cat, Rory, who sometimes will come into the house and disappear. We know he's not outside, but we can't see him anywhere. And we think, where is he? And quite often, as cats are wont to do, if we've opened, for example, the cupboard under the stairs, he'll dash in so quickly that we don't notice it, and he remains trapped inside. And we may think, oh, he's probably caught up in the cupboard under the stairs. Now, we could carry on thinking that. We could say, yeah, that's where he probably is, and allow him to be lost to us for now. But in order to find him and for him to find us, we need to open that door to seek him out and let him out. God too may seem lost to us. What we mustn't do is just shrug and accept it. Oh well, that's how I feel. It doesn't mean anything to me at the moment. He's disappeared. What we do need to do is open the door, allow God to seek you out. Taste and see him, because he is very good. And when we do that, we will share God's promise that is in verse 5 of the chapter we've been looking at. It says, then you will look and be radiant, your heart will throb and swell with joy. I do pray that our hearts will throb and swell with the joy of knowing God this year. Amen.
as we pray together. Lord, for many of us, 2020 had been a year like no other. So much has been disruptive and stressful, disturbing, and even traumatic. And it seems as though we've been through one disappointment after another. We never asked for such a stormy year, but we've weathered it. Now we turn a page, a corner. And we may even turn over a new leaf. So we pray as we say goodbye, perhaps good riddance, to 2020. For so many of us, these past 12 months came so fast that we had no time to think or recover before the next crisis hit. So, at this year's end, we breathe a bit more deeply and think reflectively and pray to you. Almighty God, clear our minds and help us to process all that we've been through in the last year. Give us wisdom. Enlighten us. Help us, especially, to see your hand at work in the world, not just the bad things that have happened, but for all the good things. The sharing of information that enabled a vaccine to be developed in such record time. For the kindness showed by neighbours. The valiant fundraising achievements and all the sacrifices that people had made. For the moments when we drew closer to you, for the times when we strayed from you, when we forgot that you were there, that you're there all the time. What did we learn? What do we still need to learn in order to move on? There are, of course, many things about the past year that we'd like to forget. But let's not be too hasty. Help us, Lord, to make peace with regrets and nurture hope for a fresh start. So, loving God, this has been a year filled with loss and pain. Hold our hands as we grieve the losses and bear that pain. Hear our prayer as we confess our sins and surrender our regrets. Wipe from our memories the things that aren't worth carrying into this new year. Help us to hold on to 2020's lessons, blessings and victories, especially the online services, reaching more people than we would have expected to see in our services, that our wonderful building is now up and running, and for the way that our St. James Church family have all pulled together, and your presence can be felt in everything that we do. So many of us saw our plans for the last year demolished as it got underway. But that doesn't mean to say we can't create new dreams for this new year. Loving God, I'm sure you understand our trepidation as we anticipate the new year. So little went according to plan last year. But those were our plans, not yours. We admit that. And a new year now unfolds before us. So let this new year mark the beginning of newness of life for us and for all whom we love. Let this year dawn in hope and proceed in hope. Let the deferred hope of last year blossom into fruitful fulfillment in this. Let this year deepen and strengthen our faith in you. And let 2021 be a year in which your love is shed abroad in our hearts and in the hearts of those around us. With new plans and dreams on the horizon, we pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts to receiving your love and guidance as you begin to put them in place. Loving God, let this new year mark a new beginning for us and for all whom we love. Grant us a new sense of your closeness and care. Give us new strength and vitality for the work ahead. Send us a new level of hopeful trust and a new sense of your closeness and care as we set out on this new normal. Fill this year with new love, new joy, and new peace, with new outpourings of patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, with new infillings of gentleness and self-control. And as Galatians puts it, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. So let this coming year be ruled by whatever is true, whatever is honourable, whatever is right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent and worthy of praise. And we pray that in 365 days from now, we'll look back with praise and thanksgiving on all the ways that you've answered our prayer, Lord, even beyond what we thought to ask. So, Lord, we now pray for a swift end to this COVID-19 pandemic. And for those infected and those exposed, we pray that they will be strengthened, healed and protective. For their loved ones, we pray for peace, comfort and endurance as they care for them. For healthcare professionals and frontline staff, we pray that they will be granted wisdom and the resources and protection in their line of work. We pray that you, O God, will grant doctors, nurses and caregivers understanding and compassion in treating their patients and protection from burnout, and to give them strength in times of tiredness and calm in times of anxiety. We pray too for those who've become unemployed and underemployed during this pandemic. Grant them, we pray, comfort, wisdom and financial provision as they strive to make ends meet. We pray that they'll be resourceful and creative and endure these difficult times. Grant them humility to persevere despite the overwhelming odds. For those who must work despite the threat of sickness lurking, grant them continued protection and provision. Direct each one of us in ways of generosity and compassion, that through our love and concern for one another, our whole society will be given strength to endure these present challenges and to work towards a shared future with hope. We pray that the people will comply with the government instructions to ensure containment and improvement of the situation. And we pray that you would grant leaders discernment and creativity to lead and minister in these unprecedented times. So let us be mindful and aware that nothing is impossible with you, Lord, and COVID-19 will pass like every other plague and pandemic in the past. Lord Jesus Christ, we come to recommit ourselves to the journey of faith, to follow you where you would lead, to bring you our worship and to offer ourselves in joyful service. Receive us in all our weakness and go with us on our way, that we may live and work for your kingdom, for we ask it in your name's sake. Amen.
I'm going to invite you to join with me in saying the Lord's Prayer. We'll say this in the, what's I suppose, a traditional version now, but it's still thought by many of us older ones to be the new version. Gathering our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to invite us now to share in the peace. That may seem a bit pointless or silly, since you're probably sitting in your home on your own, perhaps, as I'm here. But nonetheless, we are gathering with all those who will share in this act of worship, and with the many, many believers across the world. And so the peace. Our Saviour Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there shall be no end. And so I say, the peace of the Lord be always with you, and indeed also with you. Amen to that. And the final blessing. May Christ our Lord, to whom kings bowed in worship and offered gifts, reveal to you his glory and pour upon you the riches of his grace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for sharing with us in this time of worship. May God bless you and keep you. Amen.